All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming out. Also, thanks to all of the remote participants for joining this talk. My name is Christian Hildebrand, and I am from a beautiful city called Berlin in Germany. So you can find me on LinkedIn and also GitHub, and I've been developing web apps now for quite some time, and I'm currently the team lead at a company called Glöckner.ai. The Glöckner Group happens to be one of the biggest metal and steel distributors in the world, and we are operating from 13 countries and 140 locations. And this past year, we shipped around 5,000 tons of steel, which equates to roughly 5 billion euros in gross sales. So we are kind of a big company, actually. And then there's Glöckner.ai, which is also part of the Glöckner Group. And Glöckner.ai is our digital innovation lab, and also based in Berlin, Germany. And together with roughly 100 developers, UX designers, product managers, and so on, we create products that digitalize our business. Now, I suppose not many people are too familiar with the steel industry, and just to give you a bit of a background what kind of projects we are working on, we have e-commerce platforms, think traditional shops in which our smaller customers can order steel, just like you and I would order steel online. We also have a contract portal. Many of our customers don't order steel this way, but instead have yearly volume contracts, and through our contact platform, they can then manage their contracts and also request portions of their contract volume online. We also have some AI projects. Our sales reps receive all sorts of emails with PDF documents. And those documents then contain purchase orders, requests for quotes, and so on. And our platform extracts those documents and all the information that we need. Our software then also reads out all of the information and matches them with the products and so on that we have in our EIP system. So we are basically automating the complete end-to-end workflow here. We also have many other projects. You have to understand that the steel industry didn't exactly catch up with technological advancements like many modern industries. Many of our processes today are still handled via paper and fax. And it's really our job to automize and digitalize manual processes. Zero-touch automation is the goal. We want to minimize human intervention as much as possible. So Glöckner.ai has been founded in 2014, and you can imagine we managed to work on quite a few projects in that time. Our GitLab instance currently powers roughly 200 repos, with applications written in all sorts of languages like Python, Go, Java, and of course also Elixir. And we've been running Elixir in production now for more than 3 years, actually, and have been very happy with it. What you can also see on the left-hand side is a list of other technologies that we use, Postgres, Elasticsearch, RabbitMQ, just to name a few, but also things like Prometheus and Grafana for metrics, OpenTelemetry along with Jaeger and Zipkin for distributed traces and so on, and all running in our kind of amazing Kubernetes cluster, actually. 6 of our main apps these days are written in Elixir, and Elixir has more or less become our go-to language for any backend-related work. Now, Elixir and OTP are very performant to build, very great to build performant and distributed systems. And I suppose many people here work in spaces like fintech, edtech, IoT, and so on that have high scaling requirements. We don't have those in the B2B steel industry. We don't need to handle thousands and thousands of different users or millions and millions of different of requests per second. We have to deal with a complicated business domain. And if you want to build software for 13 different countries, you will also have to deal with many different business rules and workflows. So, we don't have high scaling requirements, but need to make sure that strong isolation and loose coupling between our components is critical. Now, there are also many ways to build clean and decoupled software, but for us, an event-driven approach has worked quite well. And this is basically what my talk is about today, very much a case study about us introducing events in Elixir with RabbitMQ. And of course, many things didn't work out so well. But what we have now is a really robust event handling solution that we are very happy with. So let's get started. What you can see here is an example of an order submission in one of our applications. Yeah, just imagine you're a sales rep and you are checking incoming orders. And you check if the order is correct. And if it is correct, then you will submit the order for further processing. And once you do this, really a few things need to happen. Yeah, we need to call the ERP systems, notify customers, account managers, and all sorts of other things. And also do things like handling metrics, yes, things that have nothing to do with actual business logic. And this is our first problem here, mixed concerns. We are really doing too many things at once. I also mentioned that we need to support many different countries. And what usually happens when we create new features or new products, that we do not onboard all of those countries at once. We rather onboard them one after another. And what happens with code like this, if you keep adding things, it can get nested, yeah, you add more conditions, and at some point, if you're not careful, this will become a real pain to work with and a real pain to maintain. Now, of course, we are trying to write fault-tolerant code, but if any of those function calls fails in some really unexpected way, and if you are working with very old ERP systems, this will happen occasionally, then your system, of course, can crash and end up in an inconsistent state. This happened also in some parts of our code base, and lack of fault tolerance was another problem that we are dealing with. Also, just mentioned that these functions are executed synchronously, so if they are taking a long time to execute, then this part of the system will also become very slow. So how can we make this better? The first and obvious takeaway for us was that all of these synchronous workflows really can be refactored in an asynchronous way. And for those particular examples, you could think of really spinning up a Jenkins server or handing the work over to an Elixir task. But what you want to do is probably a bit more sophisticated. What you rather want to do is take this code and rather emit an event. And if you do this, you can then have separate consumers which listen to that event, and all of these consumers can have their own dedicated responsibility. And also, if you do this, our code would also be more decoupled because we can now simply handle special workflows, exceptions, and so on in their own dedicated consumers. And if these consumers then also run in their own dedicated processes, we would also be more fault tolerant because they can crash individually and so on. Also, if those functions run concurrently and they're slow, then of course our system would also become faster. So the advantages of an event-driven approach were quite clear to us, and we decided to implement some events. Yeah? And if you want your software components to communicate via events, you need some mechanism to dispatch events in one part of your application and then consume them in another. And this is where RabbitMQ comes in. I just mentioned you could, of course, also do the communication part in Elixir. That would be no problem. Many great libraries do this, in fact. But RabbitMQ really comes with a few advantages. The first one is that it's language agnostic. There are clients for all major languages. Our software evolves, and we will likely talk to services in other languages as well. RabbitMQ also provides us with advanced message routing capabilities. Again, you don't need those if you're handling simple asynchronous background jobs, but if your system evolves and becomes more complex, then those also become interesting. RabbitMQ is also battle-tested. It's a proven technology used by people all over the world, and it also has a rich ecosystem. We have, in fact, have been using it for some of our data ingestion pipelines along with Broadway, and have been very happy with it. And that made it more or less a no-brainer for us to choose RabbitMQ. So when we first got started with event handling, we decided to tackle the more trivial cases first, which were asynchronous background jobs. And the code that you can see here is more or less what you need in order to get a simple producer and consumer combination off the ground. We decided to use the XRabbit pool package for connection pooling along with the AMQP client. And then you can go ahead and create your cluster config, your consumer supervisor, your producer, and then bootstrap everything that you need in terms of RabbitMQ and also your consumers. My God. Yes. Inside of your application. And once you do this, you can, in theory, go ahead and emit some events. Amazing. Now, we did this a few times. We created a few consumers and producers this way, and we weren't exactly happy. The first problem for us was boilerplate. Just to get something very simple off the ground, there was really a lot of code needed. RabbitMQ is very flexible, but also very complex. And you have to configure queues, bindings, exchanges, and so on, which requires a lot of code. We also didn't have any conventions for this, which didn't make things exactly easier. And of course, you would also have to duplicate all of this for your dev, test, and production environments. The other problem was bike shedding. Every time a new event was created, you would basically have to reinvent the wheel when it comes to very trivial questions. We would have to bootstrap all of the RabbitMQ components, I just mentioned this, but also error handling, yeah? Logging, metrics, tracing, and so on. Yeah? We would like to figure this out for once and not reinvent it every single time we want to implement a new event. And this was bad because we really wanted to refactor many work flows in this event way. And we really weren't exactly encouraging our developers to do so, because of all of this bike shedding and boilerplating made it really hard to create a new event. And then we were basically back at square one, in which we kept adding things to our existing consumers, and then those would become slow and unreliable again. So this wasn't really working out for us. And of course, adding more code on top of this would make things work. So we decided to take a step back and really think about what we are trying to achieve. What problem are we trying to solve, and what requirements do we have? And we really needed to consider this from two perspectives. One is the RabbitMQ perspective, right? It's a complex technology. You need to understand what features you want to use and how you want to use them. And once you have sorted that out, you can think about what you want to do on Elixir side. What kind of conventions do you want to have? What kind of abstractions do you want to come up with? Now, from RabbitMQ perspective, we still wanted to emit events. That was clear. We also knew that we wanted to have consumers that consume those events. But how exactly should those consumers then consume those events? Some events should be delivered to only one consumer, and there was another use case that we also wanted to have events which are consumed by multiple consumers. And then there was also the last use case, in which we wanted to have consumers which are able to listen to multiple events. So let's quickly examine how something like this would look on RabbitMQ side. So on RabbitMQ, a message gets published to an exchange and not directly to a queue. And it's then the exchange's job to push the incoming message to an actual queue. And on client side, you can then just start picking up messages from the queue. RabbitMQ has multiple exchange types. The exchange type we chose is a topic exchange. And inside of a topic exchange, basically two things need to happen. A message needs to have a payload, a target exchange, and also a so-called routing key. And a routing key is basically a list of words delimited by dot. And RabbitMQ allows you to then create queues which are bound to these exchanges via those routing keys. And just to visualize this, RabbitMQ will only push messages to those queues which have matching routing keys. And we decided that for all of our event handling needs, really one topic exchange is enough. It provides us with all of the flexibility that we need. And I just mentioned this, we are not dealing with high volumes of load. Yeah, one topic exchange is perfectly fine. It doesn't make sense to split up exchanges. So after sorting out this whole RabbitMQ problematic, we went on and thought about what we want to have on Elixir side. Of course, we want to have an abstraction. And we also want this abstraction to be opinionated. We want to have something that allows us to easily create new producers and consumers. And we want to have same conventions. But we still want to be able to customize when we have to. We also want the solution to be flexible. It needs to be able to cover simple background job scenarios, but also more advanced pub-sub scenarios as well. And of course, we want something that is expressive. We want it to be easily readable and maintainable. People shouldn't have to deep dive into the code just to make simple changes for any of the event-related work. And if you have ever worked with an asynchronous system, you know that it can be very difficult to debug. Of course, we want to have observability. We want to be able to trace a message in its complete life cycle. And last but not least, we also want it to be robust. We need solid error handling and also be able to retry and drop messages when it makes sense. Now, gladly, Elixir and OTP are awesome and come with batteries included. We want to reduce boilerplate, so we can just write macros that write code and code that we would have otherwise had write to ourselves. And macros also help us to write clear and simple abstractions, as you find so many in the ecosystem. And OTP provides us with all of the tooling that we need. Supervisors and gen servers can help us to build a really robust event handling platform. Now, what I would like to do now is to do a simple walkthrough what is actually necessary to get a library like this off the ground, merely with Elixir, macros, and OTP. I've just shown you what we don't want to have. What we rather want to have is something that looks like this. A producer that allows us to easily emit events, and also a consumer that allows us to easily consume those events. And this is what our API looks like today. It's very lean, very clean, and yes, there's some magic, but this is much better than what we had before. And actually, there's also not too much magic going on. Inside of our producer macro, we are now exposing a publish function, and that function allows us to publish messages to the RabbitMQ exchange. Under the hood, there's not too much happening. We are just checking out a connection from the connection pool, and then publishing messages via the AMQP library. And on consumer side, we are also adding a new macro, our consumer macro, but this time we also have a parameter, the event parameter. And this allows us to then hook into the producer's event and execute its payload. And the consumer can then, of course, acknowledge or reject a message. There's really not too many special things going on, but the question is, if we want to have an API like this, how do we get there? And there are basically three things that we have to do. The first thing is that we somehow need to dynamically generate all of this RabbitMQ configuration, right? There was a lot of boilerplate just to set up queues, bindings, and so on. We want to infer this from our producer and consumer modules. And once we have the whole configuration thing sorted out, we can dynamically set up RabbitMQ and also dynamically set up all of our consumers. So we said we need to infer the naming conventions from our model names, which is straightforward. This is our producer model, and again, it publishes a message to the app.events exchange. We said we are always going to use one exchange, so that can either be hard-coded or configured, it doesn't matter. But that message also needs to have a routing key. And in RabbitMQ, it's convention to use lowercase strings separated by dots. So we can basically just take our producer module and simply lowercase it. And if this message is then received by RabbitMQ, it gets forwarded to the exchange, and then our consumers also need to register queues. They can infer the routing key from the event name that we passed in via our macro and the queue name from the consumer model name. And once we have this, our consumers can start to pick up messages from the correct queues. And that's actually it what we need configuration-wise. We can simply infer all of the values that we need from our model names. Now, the question is, how do you get, how you take a model name like this and turn it into this? It's of course not very challenging. You need a function that looks something like this. And once you have this little neat snake case function, you can use it to convert model names into names that you can use on RabbitMQ side. So I just said that our producer needs to set messages set the messages routing key, right? And what we can now do in our producer macro is to simply take the module name and snake case it. And similarly, how we define the routing key in our producer macro, we can also generate the queue name inside of our consumer macro. And again, what we do is we simply take the consumer's module name and snake case it. And last but not least, the consumer also needs to know the routing key. Otherwise, the consumer does not know what messages to listen to. So since we passed in the source event as a parameter, we can also just convert it like we did before, right? So that event becomes that routing key. And that maybe doesn't seem like much, but we now have everything that we need to get rid of all of this boilerplate configuration, right? Our code already contains all of the information that we need. And we are also dealing with plain Elixir modules. If we want to customize something, we can just override a function, and that's it. And with that, we came up with a standardized naming model. Our producer and consumer models in Elixir can now hook up with their corresponding parts on RabbitMQ side. Now, at this point, there's really nothing that keeps us from generating our needed configuration dynamically. We could just go ahead and manually create a list of consumers and then generate the needed config. That would be totally fine, but we can also do another trick in Elixir. We can just get a list of all of the defined modules in runtime and then check if they implement our consumer behavior. And if they do, we get a list of consumers. This is great because we can now go ahead and do the two next things, which is bootstrap everything on RabbitMQ side and then implement a supervisor that dynamically spawns consumers. So let's do that. We just iterate over our consumers. I just show you how that works. And for every consumer, we declare everything that we need on RabbitMQ side. This is stripped down, of course, but for demonstration purposes, I hope you get the idea. And you simply call this from inside of your application. And now you have everything set up. And that's very much it. Now, we need to do the same thing with our consumers. Consumers are just gen servers, which are supervised by supervisors. And what we need is a list of child specs for our supervisor. And for us, this again means that we simply iterate over all of our consumer modules and then generate a child spec for each and every one of those modules. If we do this, we get a list that looks something like this, which is exactly what our supervisor needs. And now we are actually able to completely dynamically spawn all of the consumers in our application. And we are very much done now. If we want to create a simple job queue with one consumer, all we have to do is simply create a producer and the corresponding consumer. Also, if you want to have more consumers for the same event, we just have to create more consumer modules that hook into the same event. This will just work because we will create the correct queues on RabbitMQ side, and RabbitMQ will then route the messages to them because they all hook into the same event and thus have the same routing key. So let's assume we have not just one, but two events that we are interested in. If we now want to have a consumer that consumes different events, all we have to do, I just mentioned this, is override the routing keys functions. And the consumer will then pick up messages for all of these given routing keys. Let's have a look at this routing keys function. It contains a wildcard, which is actually supported by RabbitMQ. And this consumer will now listen to all of the messages that match this pattern. This is great because it provides us with a lot of flexibility. And we are almost done now. We achieved developer happiness. And now, for us at least, it's very convenient to handle events. We took this arguably very complex technology called RabbitMQ and came up with a really clean and flexible library that allows us to abstract much of its complexity away. And much of this magic really comes together beautifully, not just from macros, but also via behaviors and introspection. Now, you can, of course, also write abstractions like this in other languages. That's really no problem. But other languages do not have OTP and allow you to create a holistic solution like this in such a convenient way. Now, since we now have an abstraction, most of the code for our consumers and producers is shared. And introducing new functionality on top of this becomes very simple. We said we wanted to have observability. We can now simply add logging, tracing, metrics, and so on to our macros. We also said that we wanted our solution to be more robust and also more fault tolerant. Now, our solution today also supports that lettering, retrying, having more instances of the same consumers, and so on. And we also handle errors in a much more fault tolerant way. Covering this takes a bit more time, though, than we have today. So if this is something that interests you, just come over to our booth. We can have a chat and discuss some events. And are we done now? We pretty much are, but actually we are not. We actually want to open source all of this. We have been running all of this in production now for quite some time, and we are very much feature complete again. We have that lettering, we have all sorts that you would ever like to have. But we are not yet at the point where our solution is so general that it can be used by others. Right? There's still a lot of more work needed to get it to that point. But surprise, we are hiring. So if you want to help us with this, if you think this is an interesting project, we also have many other interesting projects to work on at Glöckner. Come over to our booth. We are gold sponsor. We are sitting right there if you have not seen us. And we can have a chat. We also have all sorts of goodies which you can grab. So come over and let's have some fun. Thank you. I hope you all enjoyed this talk. I want to give a special shout out to my colleagues, Chang, Rami, and Chris, who are the actual authors of this library. And with that, I hope you had fun. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, shoot.
All right, thank you. Are there any questions? Yeah, come on up.
Hi, thanks for the talk. Can you maybe share how you host RabbitMQ? Do you use like a dedicated provider or do you host it yourself? And
we host it ourselves in our Kubernetes cluster and we have a high availability setup.
So was that difficult to set up? Because like if you, because basically RabbitMQ is like, the messages are persisted in RabbitMQ. So if you lose the RabbitMQ cluster, then the message is gone, right?
So if you want to, if this really interests you, I can get hold of some of our DevOps and answer this question in detail. Yeah. But I cannot answer this right now.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Yeah.
Hello. The question is how your library compares to Broadway library, because it seems like they solve a similar problem. And what is the advantage of using your solution over Broadway, and what is the lack, maybe, functionality in Broadway that you try to improve?
So I mentioned that we are using Broadway ourselves for our data ingestion pipelines. Yeah, this is where it really shines. And what we are doing here is really something simple. It's event handling. Those are two different use cases. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we wouldn't use Broadway for background jobs and things like this. Yeah. But that's not what it's used for.
Thank you. Hi, I actually had the same question, but now it's answered, so I came out with another. So the question is, this RabbitMQ, we're actually also using it in our company, but we have Elixir and no JS application. So I just wonder if you have only Elixir application, why you need Rabbit, because it's already messaging and sandboxes and everything. So why Rabbit exactly?
So the first reason is if you want to build something more sophisticated when it comes to message routing, then RabbitMQ is a technology you want to choose, right? And also in Elixir, we would have to basically build things like persistence, durability, stuff like this, right? If you just have your Elixir layer and your application crashes and you're doing some critical stuff, which we are doing at Glöckner, then the data is lost, right? We need to figure all of those things out. And again, we also have many applications, and not all of them are written in Elixir. Having a message broker that's language agnostic is of great help. Yeah.
Sorry, maybe I have missed it, but when you why you have selected RabbitMQ but not, for example, Apache Kafka or NATS? Why is this message broker?
So Kafka is an event log, and if you work with streaming data and stuff like this, then it's perfectly fine. And again, we don't have any scaling issues. We want to send messages and make sure that we can have a complicated pub-sub scenarios, right? Like I just mentioned, consumers that can pick up events from different queues, and then maybe consumers which may just pick up one event and stuff like this. Yeah, you can't use Kafka for this.
What about other message broker like NATS? And actually, we have a lot of different options right now. Why RabbitMQ?
Right. I mentioned we were already using it for our data ingestion pipelines, right? And introducing a new technology is always critical. RabbitMQ is battle tested, and we also have some engineers that have experience with it. We didn't completely evaluate other message queues because we simply didn't feel that there was a need.
Mm-hmm. So right now you're completely okay with all capabilities RabbitMQ provided to you, and you don't have any issue with it, correct?
We did at the beginning. So if you don't know what you're doing and you're building asynchronous systems, you can shoot yourself in the foot quite easily, right? So we struggled a bit, right? And what we have figured out right now works very well for us. In fact, I mentioned that we also have dead lettering, retries, and those kind of things. We really implemented this in a very robust way. This runs in production, doesn't cause any issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yep. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, everyone, for your questions. Let's give Christian another round of applause.